1968. The Fillmore. There was no Fillmore East and Fillmore West. It was just the Fillmore. Bill Graham was still taking money at the door. Fistfuls of it. I walked in, the scent of patchouli and marijuana beginning to drift lazily across the room. Welcome to an unbelievable dream. You didn't have to be stoned, and I wasn't. I was unafraid. I was anointed by the holy sacrament of, well, rock music and multicolored doors leading to the ultimate experiences that only you could dream of, along with 100,000 others with whom you now seem to have complete trust. Music rose like inviting tendrils towards shifting kaleidoscopic lights that streamed across the ceiling and slithered invitingly down the walls, like water to quench your perfect desire. What was this world I entered into? I didn't care. It invited and then accepted me as the complete being I was, or at least I felt that way in that moment. Here I was, home. I was early enough to stand at the front row, and soon the crowd was surging around and at me from behind. Beside me stood a young, slight, and kind of droopy-shouldered brown kid who would shadow me at the same spot many times, right in front of the guitar player. We always kind of jostled against each other for that sought-out position. No other way to view magical hands flying across the fretboard. No video then or YouTube, that would be another then seemingly fantastic dimension altogether, many years off. I later recognized this kid when his first album was released, Santana. This big black man who I'd never heard of, Albert King, came on first. Wow, he was raw and commanding, his presence just filling up the stage, and then he started to play and slowly, baby, I was amazed. I didn't recognize the music for what it was, the blues. I was like the Native Americans who supposedly couldn't see the big Spanish ships coming right at them, sails as invisible as dreamtime wings beating at the sky. Having no context, I only felt the presence of notes and sounds that spoke volumes. Albert's huge hands tugged effortlessly at the metal strings, coaxing out the most wonderful moaning and searing sounds. They went straight into me, made me feel like jumping for joy. What was this? I'd never heard anything like this in Manila. Albert said, flew by. Then came the next act, Jimi Hendrix. And the top of my head blew off. This was beyond ultra fantastic. It was otherworldly. He obviously was someplace you needed to go, and you went willingly. The music, the visual, drew you in instantly with an intoxication that was so strong, so potent, you didn't even notice that you'd left the planet. Time stopped. His hands moved, and all was emerging of sound and light. Jimmy flowed in an androgynous way, and it seemed perfectly natural, although I'd never seen that before. I don't think anyone had. Our consciousnesses merged. Was this what we had all been waiting for but didn't know? He wasn't performing, he was being. He was manifesting something we'd all called for a long time ago. It was the ultimate seduction. I remember a lot of blue through light, scars undulating with his form, beautiful cascading riffs, his utter concentration and obvious enjoyment, all long legs and sinuous movement. A light mustache, a slight smile, just a lightness actually, caressing your every sense. Yes, this was where we were all supposed to be, so obvious and effortless. It was a magic carpet ride, all smiles and kingdom, utter assurance of the moment and looking down. He was the altar, and no sacrifice would be too great to be a part of it. This was some sort of ancient, yet so now, ritual. We all knew what we needed to do. We just disappeared with him. As I look back on that set and that night, I'm still amazed at how we were all so easily transported. It was the time and setting and the skill with which those two men played their instruments. They not only played incredibly well, both came from a tradition they knew to their core, which they then took to another level with the magic of electricity to an atomic level. I was hooked. If I didn't know it then, if I didn't know it before, I honestly knew it then. Music was my drug of choice. But really, how does a young Filipina-American woman in the mid to late 1960s get to this place? Where do the impulses come from? The courage to recognize them? There are a lot of people involved, and we need to go back to the beginning. Manila, the Philippines. 1948, the world had crashed and was reinventing itself. Change had come in a big way.
On television, The Tonight Show starring Johnny Carson. Johnny announces his musical guests of the evening, Fanny, described as the first all-girl rock and roll band to be signed to a major record label, and introduces twin sisters from the Philippines, Jean and June Millington. The subconscious registers names, and I look up to view recognizable faces, last seen 10 years earlier. Shocked, I mumble, I know them, and they aren't twins. Excerpts from June's autobiography. I was born in a country beautiful beyond measure, with sighing winds and emerald rice fields. I'm half Filipina, half American. My mother's surname, Limhoco, is exactly half Chinese and half Spanish. Lim being Chinese and Hoko with the J pronounced ha, distinctly Catalonian. I was the first granddaughter born to my mother's family after World War II. And my father was one of the conquering heroes, a graduate of Annapolis from Burlington, Vermont, a lieutenant commander in the US Navy. Filipinos loved the Americans, respected them, and were very grateful for their help in beating off the Japanese. I heard about this daily from everyone. From the moment I was born, it seemed, there wasn't a Hollywood movie or a documentary. This was fresh, and I was given a direct transmission. Put simply, Jean and I were not only biracial, we were bicultural. We were brown, all right, but light and our accent American. Our lives were framed as American in the center, but imbued with our Philippine heritage through and through, with all its societal signals. I met June Millington and her sister Jean at the American School in Manila. Jean and I were friends and classmates from kindergarten through the fifth grade, about 1955 to 1960. June was a year ahead. Our school, considered to be the best in Manila, offered a solid grounding in the performing arts, which included annual concerts by the Manila Symphony Orchestra conducted by Dr. Herbert Zipper, an internationally known music educator and Viennese survivor of Dachau, Buchenwald, and the Battle of Manila. Learning and performing Philippine folk dances like the bamboo dance Tinikling and Itik Itik, which mimicked the movements of ducks among the rice paddies, were built into the elementary school phys ed curriculum. And June was a lettered member of the swim team with a top coach, Rene Amabuyok, who had been on Team Philippines in the 1948 Olympics and at the first Asian Games in New Delhi in 1951. The American school sports teams were called American Indians. And so in that picture you're looking at now, it is the Indian Love Call, which was taken at a 1959 rehearsal for an Aqua Festival. That's June, if you recognize her, down at the first row. In 1960, the year before the move to the United States, their parents transferred Jean and June to Assumption, a girls' school run by the nuns, where they discovered ukuleles. The time was pre-Beatlemania. The Araneta Coliseum venue was new, and the American singer-songwriter Neil Sedaka came, sang, and captured the Filipino hearts, vocal cords, and airwaves. His 1961 hit, Calendar Girls, was and still is a great favorite of the Millington sisters. It is being performed tonight by Robin Hoffman and Marlene Wong of the Well-Tempered Ukes.
Two, three, four.
Like a firecracker, I'm aglow.
August.
When you're on the beach, you steal the show. Yeah. My heart's in the whirl. I love my little calendar girl every day. Beneath my Christmas tree, yeah, my heart's in the whirl. I love my little calendar girl every day of the year. I love my calendar girl, yeah, sweet calendar girl. I love my calendar girl. Every day of the year, each and every day of the
our family, minus our dad, who had gone on ahead to secure a job and a home, got onto the USS President Cleveland in June of 1961 for the 21-day journey from Manila to San Francisco. We were leaving everything we knew, the coconuts and palm trees, sticky rice desserts, our relatives, all the fruit and Asian food we knew and loved. And for what? We didn't know, but hoped for the best and knew only that it was tremendously important to my father. With six kids in tow, my mother walked around with Scott, the youngest, on a child's leash. At age three, he didn't mind, he just wanted to explore. No one took any notice, but looking back, I realized my mom was all alone with none of the usual siblings or maids along to help ease the journey. It must have been a shock. How that boat rocked, I was sick as a dog for days, unable to keep up with the unrelenting seesaw movement, not knowing that my equilibrium didn't work on one side. But all of a sudden, like magic, I felt fine. Gene and I were just switching from ukulele to acoustic guitar and made use of the time to explore the huge ship and play songs for the officers, who enjoyed it so much that they got us to perform for the passengers. Having given concerts for my mom's sisters and relatives many times, we had no problem doing it for complete strangers. And that was probably our first performance for the general public. My mom had enrolled us at the YWCA so we could swim that first hot summer, and we were signed up for a variety show in the basement, where we were noticed by some very wonderful women who encouraged us mainly by finding other venues for us to play. They were our first booking agents, God bless them. I remember a demolé function in downtown Sacramento, playing a banquet room filled with buzzing young boys in crisp jackets and ties, and then the Capper, a mental institution where I doubt our audience knew quite what we were doing, but still, it was excellent practice when we were just starting out. I think we instinctively knew we'd never have to do that again, so we just did our best. These gigs definitely prepared us for times ahead, as we could walk into any room cold. Moreover, the $15 or so that we each received further raised our self-esteem, as now we could buy our own cosmetics and simple things like toilet paper. Hey, we had our own money, we could buy 45s. So now I could play a song over and over to really learn the arrangement and notice other things like the bass line and harmonies. This was our continuing self-created young women's preparatory school of rock, which consisted of a guitar, a small portable turntable, and some records. With that, the universe really opened up. And we've chosen to do the song Stop in the Name of Love because of our that Motown music so heavily influenced our musical education. And the reason that particular song is because the first time we heard it, June and I were driving in the car, and she pulled over. We had to stop the car to listen to that song. So here it is.
Haven't I been sweet to you? Stop in the name of love. I met June and Jean in 1966 when I traveled from a small town outside of Sacramento, California to Sparks, Nevada to audition for the Svelts, an all-girl band that was looking for a girl drummer. They were playing in a club called the Lemon Tree. I was 16, not old enough to be in the bar, so I had to watch the four-piece band play their sets from the kitchen, looking through a glass porthole window in the double swinging doors. Near the end of the night, I sat in with them on stage and we played Still in Love with You, Baby by the Beau Brummels. I passed the audition. Well, there wasn't any competition. And I got the gig. So for the next few years, we lived that special bond that happens when you find those rare and special people that you can join with and bring to life a mutual dream, which was our band. In her book, June wrote about that time. We had a routine for a few years that was exhausting but exhilarating. Good students by day, rock and rollers by night, especially the weekends when we'd play after hours clubs in the Bay Area or doubled up on gigs. In between, we rehearsed whenever we could. It seemed fantastic that we found this secret door, but we had. Our job was made so much easier by being in a sort of cocoon which we always traveled with, each of us. We functioned in our other parallel lives perfectly well, it seemed. We ate, we did our homework, we got good grades, we kissed our parents goodnight, and always had that secret door and shared experiences to go to. Doing it as a group made us feel invulnerable. As soon as the drums and amps were set up and June and Jean and Kathy hit it, I tell you, there was nothing more to say. The magic carpet ride took off, and I've never felt anything more powerful in my life. Well, all that June wrote was true for me too. It was an amazing time. Performing, blowing people's minds, creating something together, and acting out our innocent, naive schemes with my best friends. Jean and I always had some, crazy adventure or mischief going on. A lot of them June didn't know about. And the ones that she did know about, well, I guess I can say that my fooling around got in the way of my work ethic. So I'm going to share with you this little known story, it's an inside story, because we did have our not so good girl adventures as well. After the Svelts moved on to Los Angeles while living in the house we came to call Fanny Hill, there was this road trip to Mexico, sound familiar, June, that we somehow found ourselves on with someone named Bob. There's a beach there that's famous now, but not in 1970. So I clearly remember the trail of clothing that each of us girls left on the sand as we made our way, stumbled our way down to the water. And you know, there's more juicy details, but I'm gonna leave those to your imagination. But later that day, or maybe the next day, while we four girls explored the town of Tijuana, Bob made his way to this grungy bar called the Boom Boom Room. drawn in by a local band and cheap beer. Apparently, the locals weren't that keen on him being there, and things started to get a little out of hand. So Bob tells him that he was there with a group of these beautiful girls that could play better than the band that just finished playing. Well, conveniently for him, we just happened to walk in at the right moment. Hey, playing was always fun for us, so why not? We played. We rocked it. The place filled up. The crowd loved it. The bar owner offered us a Saturday night gig that we had to politely decline. But we did offer to return another day to jam in his club. So, you know, we had another great adventure, and Bob didn't get his ass kicked. Yeah, girl power. You know, our shenanigans could get out of hand, and I'm sure that I gave June more than my fair share of grief. So, June, this is my better late than never apology for giving you such a hard time when we were teenagers. Today, I'm grateful. I realize that I'm pretty much one of June's original IMA students. Just pre-IMA. And what June wrote about in her book, The Camaraderie of Bands and the Music, for me, 50 years later, has been a lifetime magic carpet ride. And I can still say that today, I too have never felt anything more powerful in my life. And I love you for that, June.
I know that some gathered here tonight might not remember 1969, or may not even have been born, but I'm sure that you can all find in your memories a bedroom. a mattress and box springs on the floor, because who could afford a frame? Shelves made of bricks and wooden boards, and a lot of clutter. Against one wall is a turntable, an amplifier, and two speakers. A young woman sits on the edge of the bed or in a small chair. She is just close enough to be within reach of the turntable's arm and still have room to hold and play her guitar. The windows let in warm California sunlight, or cool evening breeze, or chilly late night air. The picture remains the same. The young woman places the needle to a record and listens for 3, 4, 5 beats and lifts the needle. Immediately she looks for and finds the notes she just listened to and plays them on her guitar over and over and over and over again until she can play that same guitar lick flawlessly. She is in this room and in this space for hours every day. She is teaching herself how to play lead guitar. This is the picture I saw day in and day out at Fanny Hill when June was forced to become our lead guitarist. And it's a picture I hold dear, but one that goes a long way to how I see her. June had to have tunnel vision in those days as we rehearsed, recorded our first albums, and seemed to be endlessly on tour. It's one of the things I love about her, and one of the things I can get craziest about. It is that characteristic in June which has brought all of you here to pay tribute. That dedication to her art and to her craft led her through the Fanny years, to the women's music years, to Anne and IMA. What a legacy she has created. A safe place for young women and girls to learn to trust themselves and their creativity. I'm so proud of you, June, and all that you do and have done. Enjoy the festivities. You deserve the accolades. When you've had a chance to breathe, get back to work. I'm beginning to work on the Mother's Pride CD release, and I'll be calling you. Love you, Alice.
Up Crescent Heights, crossing Sunset Boulevard, taking a shortcut that will take me to the street we live on, Marmot Lane, a short, sweet street just up the Hollywood Hills. I'm already very familiar with the silhouettes of the big houses ahead of me, huge mansions that were built by the movie elite of the generation just passing. We're trying to think of a band name, me and my sister Jean and drummer Alice. And as I make a left turn that will take us across Laurel Canyon Road, I mention another all-girl band I'd heard of called Daisy Chain. I love that there's a girl's name in it, and we all start trying to think of something similar. Someone calls out Fanny, and it gets added to the list that's probably up to 40 or 50 wild, kind of zany 60s, far-out psychedelic names. A few days later, I find out that our manager and record producer like that name too. And just like that, we have the name of our band, Fanny. I do not remember one other contender. Fanny was the winner by some sort of mystical process, it seems to me now. I was just 20, a bit old for today's rock standards, and we'd already been at it for 5 years. Whether or not you like that name now, in the context of political correctness and tweeting and cute or satirical blogs in which everyone can have a savage opinion, to me the name brought up a sweet aunt somewhere in the Midwest, Alice was from Iowa, or a favorite grandmother who fed you warm cookies. And it had an edge, too. Hey, this was rock and roll. We had to prove we could play like guys and we couldn't use a can opener to sway public opinion. We needed a buzzsaw. And I felt much safer with that nice lady to hide behind while that other Fanny girl tried to play as confidently as she could on stage through an amp that sang into other galaxies. We didn't want to just conquer the world. We wanted to be immortal. If it weren't for that exact moment And by that, I mean the 60s, with the assassinations and rock and roll roiling up onto the Vietnam War, and Motown keeping the beat for everyone, and feminism beginning to express itself, and California surfing, and young Englishmen trying to play and sing like black guys, and drugs and flower power, the civil rights movement, and beads, and birth control, and the concept of free love. If there hadn't been that rent in the veil, there's no chance we could have slipped through an invisible, yet completely effective wall, one that might just as well have had a sign chiseled on it that said, "No women allowed." All of that had to happen simultaneously, or at least on the heels of one another, and a lot of people got killed or drifted off into a purple haze. But we had a soundtrack, and that music is still being played today. On page 105 and 106 of your book, you reveal your top two picks for the greasiest, most badass soul tracks of all time. You're very forward about it, and it gave me my little soundtrack for today. But before I do that, I want to introduce these badass cats that are up on the stage with me, the soundtrack of today's show. On drums, Jay Giles, Peter Wolf, Marty Richards. On bass, the voice of soul in Boston, Wolf Janandez. Guitar, Joe Cocker, Robert Palmer, so many more, Cliff Goodwin. And over here on keyboards, and he will play a pivotal role in the show, as you will see. And furthermore, he's the one who introduced me to June and Ann, and so I love you for that and for so many other things. Mitch Shakur. Shall we get down to it? Are you ready to hip shake a little bit with me? Are you ready to hip shake a little bit with me? All right, cats, hit it! Woo!
Walking the dog, just a walking the dog over here, baby. If you don't know how to do it, I'll show you how to walk the dog. Woo! Muscle Shoals, Alabama, my second home, was your number two pick. Ow! Guess you better slow your Mustang down. Now you're going round say now, what I say.
Female guitars I've been exposed to, because I've been studying blues since I was 12. You know, Mama Thornton and that whole, I saw that, you know, the Delta and the Chicago and that kind of stuff. As far as guitars in general, June's probably one of the first female guitar players that I was exposed to. She knows what she's doing. She's an excellent guitar player. She definitely She's probably a lot more versatile than I am. I think that June can do things that I can't do. Or too stubborn. I don't know. I play like I play. But I've seen June. I think she's a very adaptable guitar player, which I'm really not. She plays with a lot of feel. You know, she's really, really a good guitar player. Period. I do know that historically, as far as musicians go, it was without a doubt harder for a woman to get taken seriously and hired as a musician than a man. That's, you know, that's a fact. Fanny was a bit of an anomaly, though, because going back that far, I don't know about California, but in Brooklyn and places where, you know, where I come from, girls weren't putting bands together. Guys were. If Fanny didn't exist, I don't think the other ones would have. Maybe in time, but not when they did. And anybody, because I know Lita Ford really well, and they all will admit, Kathy Valentine also from the Go-Go's, right? Both good friends of mine, and that just love Fanny. And they will tell you straight out, Fanny kicked open the door and they walked through. June is a very talented person. I think that she cares a lot about musicians. I think she cares a lot about music. You know, I like the fact that she's put together an organization to help people out. She knows what she's doing. She's got a great facility. And, you know, you teach people something the right way, and you can change somebody's life. And music will change people's lives more than just about anything on this planet.
When I was 19, I was hired by Barry Rothman to be his secretary at Warner Brothers Reprise Records, and I couldn't take shorthand or type, but I looked good. All the secretaries, including myself, sat in cubicles down a long hallway. The men we worked for had their offices behind us. Richard Perry's office was next door to my boss, and his secretary, Keo, had the cubicle next to me. One morning, Richard came over and he said, "I need you to welcome a group of girls I'm signing." He asked me to look out for them and escort them into the empty office down the hall and keep them company till he got there. To say I was gobsmacked when June, Jean, Alice, Addie, and Linda Kavars strut down that infamous hallway in their jeans and t-shirts, no makeup, long hair down their backs, is mild. I was stunned and in awe. I was used to guys walking by, but these were girls just like me. Girls who played their own music and were recording. Not just some guy musician's old lady sitting around watching him play. You have to remember, or imagine if you're young now, that 1969 was not a bonanza year for girl musicians, let alone all-girl rock and roll bands. But I was lucky to be chosen to spend a few precious minutes alone with the girls that day because it changed the trajectory of my life. I remember asking June, "Hey, what can I do?" She said, "Well, can you play piano?" And I said, "Yeah, sure." And she said, "Well, why don't you come by the house and try out?" So I went there that very night. And we all hit it off, but I couldn't play piano well enough to join the band, sadly. But however, that did not deter me from coming back to hang out because Fanny Hill was magnetic. The house, an old Spanish-style mansion rented for the band by Warner Brothers, was up above the Sunset Strip at the top of Marmont Lane, above the Chateau Marmont. The girls were paid a monthly salary, just barely enough cash to scrounge by doing their own laundry and eating frugally, but they had all the time in the world to write and rehearse and jam and come up with songs for their first album. My dad had been a cinematographer, and I learned photography from him. Since I couldn't be the piano player, June passed me her dad's Leica and suggested I be the photographer, and I moved in. June had put together a makeshift darkroom behind the rehearsal room, right back there behind the girls, which I took over. Fanny Hill was an outrageous place to live. It was at the same time home for us girls, where we baked muffins daily, which were delicious, as well as a serious place of music making. There were always people coming and going, jamming, staying up all night, staying overnight, or living there for periods. There was June's family, of course, and Jean's family. Alice's sisters were there, Abby and Evelyn, and Nikki and her mom, and Richard. Oh, so many people. Alice's friends came, and Bree with her baby girl, and Jackie Furman, Denny Hall, and Trett, and Julie, and Maggie Corey, and Louie, and my mom and June's mom cooked together. Lowell George, he was a regular. He used to come and jam with June, and they would play all night long. And of course, Richard Perry came by to work on songs. But there was Bernie Taupin and Dave Mason and Rick Danko and Chris Williamson and Levon Helm. And I brought Joe Cocker one night, who came for dinner and to go to a show. Bless his heart, Joe. Witnessing the level of focus, intention, discipline, practice that these girls were committed to, and the way they held themselves with so much confidence, taught me I could ask that much from myself as well. But more importantly, I was changed by June's trust in me. You were so viscerally trusting and unwavering, June, in that sense that I could do this, and it gave me all I needed. And Jean, you were the greatest girlfriend. All those years, this feeling of sisterhood that we've shared among us has been a very deep, deep healing experience for me. I arrived at Fanny Hill with a lot of bluster and insecurity and a great longing to belong. And I left Fanny Hill with a sense of power, purpose, and direction. Funny thing is, Fanny Hill has never left me. To this day, I can reach back anytime I feel the need and anchor myself to those beautiful people and those extraordinary shared times.
Cliff and I were on tour in Dusseldorf, Germany, and we got up to the theater, and the piano tuner was there with us. He said, "How do you like our blues and our 12-foot? It's the treasure of our city." Cliff looked at him, looked at the piano, looked at me, and said, "Not for long, buddy." All right, you ready, baby?
Said help is wanted, not enough. Times out here are getting rough, and no matter what you do, you can pray to the heavens above, no matter what you get from her. It's long distance of love, long distance love.
To be here. These are not words to the next song. It's my shopping list. I don't want to forget anything later when I go home.
Not for long, buddy.
Better, better. I think this one. Yeah, I hear you.
Can I ask you a question? Does anyone dislike the fact when people just leave that dang tuner on the whole show, sitting there? You like it, I guess. I'm sorry.
Put it back on. We'll do it with double amount.
Oh, here you go. Now you're Cliff Key.
Uh-oh.
Yeah, you can do that in Northampton.
Yeah! Hey, so,
what's that? Behind closed doors. Out in the open's cool too, though. Right. All right. I was told my amp was too loud, which I actually turned the volume down from when you played. I guess they just like it better when you're there, right?
Okay, hold on.
With all those sunny folk and having fun, and I was out on the East Coast playing in the bars, playing with Howlin' Wolf and Big Mama Thornton and Freddie King and Bonnie Raitt. And so here's the Lowell George connection. But I got to tell you something else. I remember when I was in high school and someone said, "Hey man, you got to hear this group. They're really good. They're really good for girls." And I stopped. Now, if you know the women in my life, you know that they're strong and right. And I said, "They're really good." That's it. Doesn't matter what it is. Hey, so let's do this. Key A.
Oh, look at this. You know what to do, right?
Really?
Yeah.
I'm gonna need some more mic on this thing. Give me some more, baby. Come on, crank it up. This is rock and roll. Yeah, go ahead. It's all right. Make sure it's on the 2 and the 4, though, all right? And don't you know that I'm willing? Yes, I'm willing. Turn me up, baby. I don't know you the dirty, don't you know? See my pretty Alice in every headlight. Oh, Alice, Alice, Alice. Been the Tucson to catch some carry, to have to beat a town and bar. Been in every kind of rig that's ever been rolled. Even roll the back of so wouldn't get away. Did you give me wheeze? Why saying why? Come on, show me sign, and I'll be willing to keep on moving. By the snow, been by the sleet, on my shin, I'm still on my feet, but I'm still, yes, I'm still. Been blowing the smokes in Mexico, let my son on every time I go to Mexico, yeah, yeah. Been a Tucson that you can carry, just have to beat it on and fall. Drinking every kind of reggae that's ever been made. Even though the back of soul wouldn't get away. Yeah, if you give me weeds, why saying why? Come on, show me a sign, and I'll be willing to keep on moving, moving. Some carry to have to beat a town and bar, doing every kind of rig and silver moon bay. Even roll the backwards so I wouldn't get away. Just to give me weeds, white sand and white. Come on, show me the sign, and I'll be willing to keep on moving.
after a Lake Street Dive concert in Northampton, which is the band that I sing in. And I was pretty immediately just struck by her countenance and her presence, and she was so generous and complimentary and encouraging to the whole band after we played. And we were having a conversation, and I remember this very well because she just very point blank was like, well, do you consider yourself a feminist? And I was like, well, yeah. Mostly because I'm a woman and I consider us equal to men. But she said it really point blank to me, and I was really struck by how much I could tell she meant when she asked the question. She was like, oh, you know, you're a feminist. It wasn't casual. She was just like, do you consider yourself a feminist? And then she asked me about that, like what that means to me. And I was like, I don't know. I don't even know if I've ever really answered that question fully. And then she spoke to me about it in a really eloquent and profound manner, and it stayed with me ever since then. It's she doesn't just say she's a feminist, she lives it. You know, she works with women in the field that she is so well versed in music, and young girls, in order to empower them to know that they have as much of a voice in music as anybody does, and they can do as much as anybody does. And it doesn't matter if you want to run your own sound, or be an engineer, or be a guitar player, or be a singer, or a songwriter, or you want to do all of that yourself, she lets them know, and she teaches them that they can do that too. Just as much as any man. And I don't think I need to explain that there's an inequality, an imbalance in that currently in our society. And so it's not just a mentality for her, it's a way of life. And that's really exceptional because there's a lot of people out there that spout these beliefs and they don't live them. And I think she wakes up, you know, I think when she wakes up in the morning, when she goes to bed at night, I think all of her, what she's done all day has been, you know, living those beliefs, which is very inspiring. It made me really want to step up and do more. As soon as you come here, you realize that there's just like a different magical energy. And everybody gets it as soon as they walk in. You know, they June and Anne have created such an incredible environment of, there's just no ego, and everybody sort of just like checks their stuff at the door, and they come in, and I was blown away by how open the girls were that I worked with. And learning that a lot of them had come up going to these camps, I can't help but feel like they got it from coming to this place and feeling that safety. It's one thing to have been present for one of the most amazing and interesting chunks of time in musical history, which June was there for. And it's one thing to be a very talented musician, but it's a whole other thing to dedicate your life to taking those experiences and those skills and giving them back to your community every single day. Her entire life is wrapped up in doing just that. And not a lot of people will take the time or have the energy to do that. And I think that that's really special. And I think that that she deserves to be celebrated for that purpose.
June Millington has been a force in pop and rock music by women for as long as I can remember. And in the very early 80s, I called her up and I said, June, this is Holly Neer. And I hired June to produce a recording for me that would lean into the pop world more than the folk and musical theater that I was accustomed to. She did an amazing job of walking that line, not so rock that I would feel out of water, and yet with a definite June groove. I called the recording Fire in the Rain. And it was the biggest selling recording I had had to date. Even later, I think those numbers were only rivaled by my collaboration with the late, great Ronnie Gilbert. June and Anne started the first IMA out in California, where I live, and it was a great space. Ronnie and I recorded a live album there. The vision of IMA grew, and after the move east took place, I was so moved by the new direction. A place for girls and young women to learn and play rock and roll. I can't think of anyone who could better guide these girls to the joy of playing rock and roll. June's song, Play Like a Girl, says it all. And Anne's experience as an educator fits perfectly into the work that they do together. Because of June's, yes, Anne. And because of June's long-standing work in music, she draws a powerful lineup of teachers each year. Singers, drummers, recording engineers, because of course if you're gonna play rock and roll, you gotta know about your gear, right? That's a big part of it. Recently, I did a panel with June at the 40th anniversary of the National Women's Music Festival in Madison, and she spoke of her life in the Philippines and the racism that still follows women of color in the music world today, so it's a double whammy. She not only plays like a girl, but she plays like a brown girl. And the result is fantastic. Powerful, funny, tender, edgy, highly crafted, smart. And I thank you, June. I am honored to be honoring you. I am open. And I am willing for to be hopeless would seem so strange. It dishonors those who go before us. So lift me up to the light of change. There is hurting in my family, and there is sorrow in my town. There is a panic all across the nation, and there is wailing the whole world round. But I am open and I am willing. And I am willing for to be hopeless, for to be hopeless. It seems so strange. It dishonors those who go before us, those who go before us. So lift me up to the light of change, to the light of change. May the children see more clearly, and may the elders be more wise. May the winds of change caress us, even though they burn our eyes. But I am open, and I am for to be hopeless would seem so strange. It dishonors those who go before us. So lift me up to the light of change. Give me a mighty oak to hold my confusion. and give me a desert to hold my fear. Give me a sunset to hold my wonder, and give me an ocean to hold my tears. But I am open and I am willing, for to be hopeless would seem so strange. It dishonors those who go before us. So lift me up to the light.
Congratulations on this wonderful evening of tribute from all your friends who I know are gathered there. I wish I could be there, but I'm sending myself in a virtual manner, which I'm just to do. I'm hearkening back to 75 when we first met around the making of The Changer and The Changed. I didn't really know you, I just knew your work and didn't really have a prayer that you would deign to come in and play on my little album. But you did, and I think Jackie Robbins asked you, and you said yes, and you sailed into the session, and you've been my friend ever since. You've taught me so much musically and encouraged
me in my work, helped me carry my work and music out to the world, made me sing backup on a lot of your songs, which was amazing because the parts are so different, one after another, and you just have to learn them. But we all did it for you because we love you so much, June. So I want to thank you for all you've done for me and all that you've done for the world, especially those girls who every summer rock the camp. IMA is amazing. You made it come true. You and Anne, I want to praise you highly for that and for allowing me to be a small part of that dream as well. Dream on. Dream on, King Queen. Love you so much.
Hello. Hi, June. Hi, Anne. It's a very great honor to be here tonight amongst all these great women and men. And I was at the first IMA camp here on the East Coast with Naya Kete as well, and that's where I learned to play guitar and sing. And I'm playing this song tonight because of a little something that happened at one of these camps. I was with the young girls in the porch, that's where we were sleeping, and I couldn't sleep, and I heard this music coming from the living room, and I came in, and June was sitting there with her white hair, like a mermaid, flowing everywhere, singing, "Do You Believe in Magic?" And I was like, "I do." I'm gonna play it for you tonight.
I had a stereo guitar, a Gibson ES-355, and with my deaf left ear, took it as a challenge to create a stereo spread on stage. That meant that I had two amps on either side, and the guys created a cable that allowed me to feed it into both. I couldn't hear one side very well, but hey, that never stopped me. Gene was always fooling around with the amps too, and we were constantly egged on by all the players around us, inventive and at the top of their game. That techno thing, now that really was like one great big clubhouse. I put Little Feet at the top of the list of the troublemakers because their sound was, in that rock way, very pristine. Every one of them had a very rough-edged approach, but it was well-contained. Lowell George's sound, of which there was always a holy grail that was being actively sought, was like a crystal that blossomed in your ear. You could hear everything, and his style was designed to be clear and penetrating. It was the best, and believe me, we were always poking around. Gene had come to LA with an acoustic 360. We both had Vox amps in the beginning, because the Beatles had them. But we experimented with Fender, then Trainer, then back again. There were others along the way, but once something worked, we would stick with that. Key to staying with any combo was producing a sound that was sort of a signature, something that worked within the ensemble that would, well, turn people on and keep them riveted to the dance floor. The Fender Twin ended up doing it for me, but that was in tandem with a Leslie speaker, which I would switch on along with another regular amp, which then would beef the whole thing up and make it sound like a magical mystery tour. I know it sounds like I'm talking about cars here, but those were serious amounts of SPL, sound, coupled with decibels, volume, which you could certainly equate with horsepower. People who've never entered into that magic circle would just never know. They'd enjoy the contoured edges that were offered as hit songs and performances, but not the raw sounds. When you play together, it tones the components down because of the blend. Your ear makes sense out of it. Sound from amps comes out at knee level and goes past our legs. As it continues on offstage and beyond, it expands like a horn. So standing next to your amp, you hear it and feel it. It's the raw stuff. That's the important and, to me, seductive part. The throw after it comes off of your fingers and is flung out to the world in nanoseconds, that's another feeling altogether. It flies past your legs and doesn't hurt you. If you have control of the sound, then it becomes magic. You have a rig. Don't ask me how, because I know that after all, setting up the setting of sound levels, tuning, positioning, and gathering of wires and muttering of incantations, the moment you disappear, you know you're in it. And then you're in a place where it's craft, it's art. You've shaken hands with the sublime. It's not loud in there, it's quiet. The gods have been subdued. You're now riding waves of pure sound, vibration as one.
Hello. My name is Lee. I'm June's nephew. I'm very honored to be here. This is Naya Kete. Some of you may know her. She is a Northampton local, an IMA camper.
Alumni.
And we're going to do a couple songs for you guys. So this first one is a song of my Aunt June's, though I have taken it and kind of done my own version. Hopefully it does you justice, Auntie June. It's one of, I keep saying there's a list of top five of my favorite of June's tunes, and there's about 50 songs in there. And this is one of them. It's called Woman Who Sees the Signs. Thank you.
There's so many people in the belly of the whale trying to hide the belly of the whale. There's so many people in the belly of the whale with fear in their eyes.
How did they get there?
Will they create the dark?
How did they get there?
And they just can't see.
How did they get there?
Stay within the dark.
How did they get there?
For only to leave
every day.
The woman sees the signs, cradle in the darkness. The woman sees the signs, chase away the darkness.
How did they get there?
Women create the dark.
How did they get there?
Where they just can't see.
How did they get there?
To stay within the dark.
How did they get there?
For women to leave
every day.
Woman who sees the signs.
Woman who hears the silence. The woman who sees the signs. Woman who hears the silence. The woman who sees the signs. Woman who hears the silence. The woman who sees the signs. Woman who hears the silence.
It's in our time
Thank you very much. So I'm gonna hand it over to Naya here. Her and I play in a band together. We're called Say Real, and we've just been so incredibly supported by June and Anne and IMA and my mom and all of the beautiful people that we had the grace of growing up with. But yeah, I'll turn it over to her.
I'm kind of wishing in this moment I'd prepare something to say. Turns out I write songs much better than I write speeches, so I'll just say something from the heart. I feel so, like Holly said, incredibly honored to be honoring you tonight, June, and oh God, it's very emotional. It feels like a very emotional day today. I think because I grew up in a musical family, and so when I came to IMA, it felt like an extension of that family. And I take that family with me everywhere I go, and in every song I write, and we write together and with our band. And everything that I'm learning here tonight about June and Gene and all the music and where it's come from is so, so meaningful and moving to me because it's family, you know, and I really feel that way. So this song, like Lee said, is a song that we wrote with our band Say Real, and it's called Sisters, and it felt appropriate to sing for you all today. So we hope you enjoy it, June. Thank you for everything. Something you see.